Welcome to the Collector's Catacomb. We are at episode 5 for 2015, and tonight we've got our special guest, Rob Morrison, talking about pens, and the rest of our panel talking about other collectibles and things they've picked up recently and whatnot. So if you've not tuned in before, we do this every week on Thursdays from 9:30 to 11. We start off with our introductions and then go into our guest, and then after that, the panel shares their items. So without further ado, myself, I'm Erik Castle. I go by TRR, Tinker's World Relics, Tinker's World Retail. I run the Allied Militaria Forum, if you've ever been on there. I do some YouTube videos, and I'm involved in the Reseller Society. Oh, somebody's got YouTube unmuted.
I'm muted.
I'm muted.
I just checked.
Rob, you got your YouTube muted?
I don't hear it.
Oh, YouTube. I don't think I'm on YouTube. Let me make sure.
Unless it's me. I'm on headphones.
Brian.
Hold on, it's Brian. It might be me.
It was you.
It was me.
Oh, hi, man.
Oh, okay.
Blooper. But hey, yeah, so I'm in the antiques military.
That's a relief.
I love some older stuff, you know, in addition to, you know, doing all the retail stuff that I do and whatnot. So we're here to just talk about collectibles, and that's what I enjoy talking about. So we'll move on to my master of ceremonies, Brian. Let him introduce himself, and then we'll go down through the panel.
Hi there, I'm Brian. I also go by Arbitrage Albatross on YouTube, and I got a Facebook page under that same name. Admin for the Collector's Catacomb, Reseller Society, the Morning Show, a few other things. So, yeah, I do a lot of different things. Yeah, I guess that's it about me. I'm going to be watching for your questions over here in the chat, and I'll be transferring those from the YouTube chat to the Google Hangout chat so the rest of the panel can see it.
Awesome. Thanks, Brian. We'll move over to Chad, the Golden Finger Picker.
Hey, folks. I'm Chad, the Golden Finger Picker. My wife is Kim, the Florida Picking Queen. We're a team. One of these days, I'll get her in here to help me because she's better at describing things than I am. But, I'm one of the founders over at the Reseller Society. If you haven't checked that out, please do. We've got a YouTube channel. It's the Golden Finger Picker. And we just love the history behind things, so that's us.
And you love to do hangout.
You know, it's been like a month and a half, but yeah, we enjoy being with everybody.
Awesome.
And he's frozen.
Oh, he froze. And he's
frozen. Take it away, Drew.
Hey, I'm Drew, the California Picker. I have a channel, YouTube channel called California Pickin'. I specialize in fine art, antiques, and vintage collectibles. I sell at the flea markets. I do eBay. Haven't dove into Amazon quite yet, but looking forward to that. And it's good to be here tonight. I'll be showing you a couple nice things, so stay tuned.
Awesome, Drew. And then we've got Dan and More Old Stuff.
Hi, guys.
He's our interim panel member when somebody can't make it. And so far, Elena is MIA. So looks like we're going to be blessed with Dan again this week.
So I'm going
to go ahead and introduce yourself, Dan.
Yeah, hi, guys. I'm Dan at More Old Stuff, and that is the name of my YouTube channel. When I go out and do all my discovering and treasure hunting, I try to take videos, and I like to, when I show you the videos I'm focusing on, when I'm looking at the stuff and I'm showing you things on my videos, you're seeing it like for the first time that I am. I mean, I'm unloading it, and I may not have opened a door onto something or, you know, tried something out or plugged something in, and I'm trying to, you're going to be doing along with me. So if like a $1,000 bill pops out of some box somewhere, you're going to discover it with me. So that'll be exciting, right? If that ever happens, right?
Right.
So anyhow, Yeah, appreciate it if you go over there and check out my channel. I'm trying to build it up and weekly stuff. So anyhow, I'm here. I may step away for a second since I just came in here, and I'm going to go down and get my pick of the week in just a second. But thanks, guys, for having me on.
Awesome, Dan. Thanks for being here. All right. And then finally, we have Rob. He's here to talk about pens this week. So, Rob, go ahead and introduce yourself and let the viewers know who you are, and then we'll move on with your stuff.
Okay. My name's Rob Morrison. I live in Asheville, North Carolina. I buy and sell fountain pens. I've been interested in fountain pens for, I don't know, 30 or 40 years. I sort of discovered the world of collectible fountain pens in the late 80s. I have several areas that I'm interested in, and which brings me to my first subject: why do people collect pens? People have lots of different reasons. For me, I got interested in fountain pens because of how they write. I was always interested in writing equipment since I was a kid. And fountain pens were what people used before there were modern ballpoints, before there were computers. If they had to make a permanent mark when they could, and therefore couldn't use a pencil, they used a fountain pen. And they were a little bit better. They were an improvement on what went before, which was just a dip pen that you had to dip in a bottle of ink and then use. Let's see. Let's go back. What is a fountain pen? A fountain pen is a pen that carries its own reservoir of ink. Generally, they look kind of like this. They have a cap that you unscrew. They have a nib that is what you actually write with, which is this thing. It's usually gold. In the golden age of fountain pens, from about 1910 to 1950, they were almost always gold. And then they have some way of holding their own ink. This one is a Waterman from the 1920s, and it holds its own ink in a sack made of soft rubber that's inside the barrel. And the way it fills with ink is you dip it in ink, you pull on the lever, that depresses the sack, and then you release the lever, and that releases the sack, and it sucks the ink out of the bottle and into the barrel of the pen. Before fountain pens, people used pens like this. This is a Victorian dip pen. It's beautifully made, and there's a lot of workmanship that goes into this, and a lot of the traditions that are part of the fountain pen world started out in the dip pen era. For example, numbering nibs based on size. This is an off-brand pen, not a famous maker, but it has a number 6 nib. The number 6 is on the nib. And that way of gauging pen nibs by their size continued into fountain pens. So, for example, this Waterman from the 1920s, which is a fountain pen of the kind that I collect, has a number 2 on it because it has a very small nib. One of the things that people love about pens is the same thing that people love about old stuff. I like old stuff because somebody has already made their margin on this old object, like these old eyeglasses, and they've already manufactured them to very tight tolerances, sometimes in ways that are unavailable or unknown today and of much higher quality than what you can get today. Same is true of fountain pens. You look at a pen from the 1930s, say, and you look at the detail of how it's made, and it's something that is... Now I'm waiting for that to focus. Now it's not going to do it. There we go. And you can see that the fine detail on the feathers of this Parker Vacuumatic Maxima from 1938 is more precise than almost anything you would find today in a writing instrument or any kind of personal item, because it just... they don't have the machines to do it anymore. And you can do it made of solid gold, but you can't do it made of gold fill, which is what this is, because it adds that extra layer of gold on top of the brass. So fountain pens started in around 1900. There were pretty good ones earlier, like in the 1880s, 1885. And the first ones didn't have any sort of rubber sack at all. They were just hollow tubes that you had to fill with an eyedropper. So, for example, this is a Waterman from around 1910. It's kind of a nice one because it has 14-karat trim. This clip is 14-karat as opposed to gold fill. This band is 14-karat as opposed to gold fill. It's a number 2 size nib, not a large nib. And the way you fill it is by unscrewing... this one's not unscrewing, so... There we go.
Rob, what's the larger size? Is it a 4 or a 3?
The bigger the number, the bigger the size.
Yeah, so a 4 is like on your bigger pens?
A 4 isn't all that big. An 8 is big.
Now, what does that do? Is it to make a wider line? Or
it's just the size of the nib. So, for example...
This is a 2. Rob, when you say size, is that as in length or width or?
Well, that changed over the years, so it's not totally reliable. And they sometimes, when they stopped using actual numbers that were written on the nib, they kept referring to them by number in house. So, for example, the Schaefer Company would call their largest size nib a number 8, even in the 1940s when the nib didn't actually have a number written on it. And the number 8 size nib actually changed over the decades. So it's really just a guide. It doesn't
really correspond with a size.
It corresponds to a size compared with the same nibs made by the same company at the same time.
Okay. So what's the point of having different size nibs? What is the difference between different sizes?
Probably the length of it
or the size of it. Does it give a different writing style? What's the point of a different size nib?
It doesn't give a different writing style because, there were number 2 nibs that were made to be stiff, they were made to be broad, they were made to be flexible, they were made to be not flexible. They really are just a way for the company itself to distinguish between the sizes of nibs and therefore the sizes of, in some cases, the sizes of the model pens that they made. So, for example, this is a Waterman 12 from 1910 to 1920. It's kind of it's a little bit skinnier than, say, this, which is called a 58. See the difference in the size of these two pens?
Yeah.
Right.
This had a number 8 nib, and this had a number 2 nib.
It's got to be the size of the diameter of the pen, of the shaft that it goes into.
Yeah. You had to have a different... It varied, because, for example, at certain times, like in the 20s, Waterman made a number 2 size pen and a number 4 size pen, and the number 2 size pen and the 4 size pen actually had the same size, the barrel and the cap were the same size. The only thing that was different was the size of the nib, and the section had to be a bigger bore to hold the number 4 nib in the pen.
And
if you were to look on them...
The bigger pens probably had larger bladders too, right?
Yes, almost always. Like, for example, if you took this is a 58.
Yeah.
This has a number 8 size nib. This has a number 2 size nib. You can see that the barrels are a different size. So therefore, when you go to fix the to replace the bladders, you'll use a bigger one in this pen than you will in this pen.
Got it.
Right. Cool. So let's ask you a few couple questions, and we'll keep going into some details on pens. You said you carry some pens personally. So is that your favorite pens, or or is that you carry pens that just work the best?
Well, for me, it's how they write that is most interesting. So, for example, I have the pens that I carry myself. This is a Parker 51 set from the 40s, and it is a particular. It's a pen that was very popular. Some of them are valuable. Some of them aren't. They had a lot of design differences that determine that. You know, some they had different. They had caps in different patterns, and they changed over the years. This one happens to be somewhat valuable, but not super valuable. But I just like the way it writes, and I happen to have a nib in it that suits me, so I use it every day. There are other things about other pens that I like. For example, there was a brand of pens which was, it was a minor brand, it was a high quality pen, but not, it was not on the top tier. It wasn't up with, the brands you'll see are Conklin, Schaefer, Waterman, Parker, Wahl, W-A-H-L. Hold on a second. I'll get it.
All right. Hey, while Rob's doing that, Brian, who do we got in the chat?
Oh, we got all kinds of people over here in the chat. Let's start
let's
out
do
with
some shout outs while Rob's getting some pens together here.
Start out with
this is a brand.
Rob, like, oh, you got your
okay.
Show.
So this is a brand called Moore, which I just happen to like. And I happen to like the ones they made at a certain time because they're very comfortable to use. And so I have a little collection. And even though I buy and sell pens for a living now, I've managed to squirrel a few of these things away that I just keep. And, you know, everything has its price, but the price on these particular ones hasn't been met yet.
Right. I think as collectors, we all have... We all have items like that in our collection.
Yeah.
So when did they go from writing with feathers to having the pen invented?
Well, the pen, that is a steel point that you would dip in ink and write with, that started in probably late 18th century.
Okay.
For that, we're talking about stuff like this. I'm also a calligrapher, and I use steel nibs like this that you put on a wooden holder. And that's the way people wrote from the early 19th century until fountain pens became more common in, you know, around the 1890s, 1900s, something like that.
But they really did, when you see in the movies, they really did use, like, you know, the large duck feathers and stuff like that. Was that, is that just...
They really did.
...movies, or is that really was the way they used to write?
Oh, yeah.
They really did use feathers. You can bite, you can get a turkey feather, and you can use a pen knife. That's what the name pen knife comes from. Is it was the knife that was used to make a pen out of a feather. You have to cut it a certain way, and you write with it. And that's how... For example, the Declaration of Independence was written.
That's what I was just going to say.
Okay, okay.
Cool.
Well, you can never believe what you see in the movie, so.
Yeah.
And, Rob, is there a country of origin that gets the credit for the pen, the fountain pen? Was it England?
Well, that's one thing about fountain...
Japan?
They were
into calligraphy, but they did it with brushes.
They were. They did it with brushes. Believe it or not, one thing about fountain pens that's interesting and fun for us collectors here in the U.S. is that the dominant companies during the golden age of writing instruments from the 1910s to the 1950s were all American companies. And the companies in Japan and in Germany and in England actually copied our designs. But it was the designs that originated in the big American companies like Schaefer in little towns like Fort Madison, Iowa, or for Parker, it was Janesville, Wisconsin. These companies in these little towns made pens that were the most famous, best designed, most imitated pens in the world. And that was at a time when a pen was an important thing. It was before there was a computer. If you wanted to be able to write with something that you could carry around in your pocket, you had to carry a fountain pen.
Yeah. And the fountain pen made it, you know, you didn't have to mess with the ink, like you said, and dipping the ink, and it was all self-contained.
It was all self-contained. Now, different pens did a better job at that than others. I mean, it's still, you can make a mess with a fountain pen.
Hey,
but
Rob.
In theory, if you do it right, the ink stays in the pen and goes onto the page and not onto your fingers.
Hey, Rob, so if you, you know, as we find these pens, is there like a specific way to handle them? Is there things not to do on a pen?
Yes.
And things to do on a pen?
Yes.
Or, you know, give us the guidelines, like what we're allowed to touch on an ink pen.
Yes. Okay. I will tell you. Okay.
Can I lift that handle now or no?
Yeah, like Do not pull the handle! No!
How about scratching it across the stone?
That is rule number one, is when you find one of these, this is a Waterman 58 from the 1920s, it's worth about $600. Because it's the big one, it's not the small one, it's the 58. And what you don't want to do, I know it's almost irresistible, but what you do not want to do is pull on this lever right here. Because when you pull on this lever, you're pushing against a hardened rubber sack, which is as hard as a rock from sitting around for 80 years. And when you pull on it, it hits against the hardened rubber sack, what it does is it breaks the outside of the pen.
I did that 2 weeks ago. You want to see what happened to my pen?
Oh, is it all right?
I have a perfect example of what the plastic looks like after it breaks.
Ah.
Ah, yes.
This is before you got in touch with Rob.
And the other thing is, it's usually not worth it to attempt to clean a pen, because cleaning requires a little bit of expertise. And it's very easy. For example, these pens are made of hard rubber, the early ones, before about 1924. Schaefer started the first plastic celluloid pens in 1924. Before that, everything was hard rubber. So hard rubber is a Waterman from the 20s, this one. And you can see it's a little bit darker than this Conklin from the 20s. And that's because exposure to light and moisture discolors the hard rubber. So if you have a hard rubber pen like this or this that you found, if you try to clean it, especially with water, you can discolor the material and decrease the value very easily.
Is the material Catalan or a Bakelite type of material?
Catalan? No. It's neither of those things. They're
Vulcanite, right?
Vulcanite. That's what it is. Yeah, they went on to celluloid in the late 20s, in the mid to late 20s. But before that, it was all what is sometimes called vulcanite. Pen people call it hard rubber, and that's the stuff that will discolor. Now later on, they started using celluloid, and some of the first celluloid pens. It's actually kind of interesting, because DuPont developed celluloids in different colors at different times. So the companies would come out with pens 1 year, and it would be like the biggest thing of the year. So for example, there was 1 year when Schaefer came out with green, that was the first color, and it was this green. Mm-hmm. And then 1 year they came out with black and pearl, which is this.
Mm-hmm. That's nice.
Right? And then another year they came out with, you know, another slightly different shade of green. I don't have any examples of any of the other ones handy. But one thing, this is another thing about materials, is that this celluloid that they use can discolor. And, you know, I told you not to try to clean a pen. Well, another reason not to try to clean it is there's some things you can't fix. So, for example, these are two Schaefer pens from the 1930s. You can see that this one has nice bright color. This one has discolored. pen people disagree on the cause of this fading, but this is a celluloid pen, and it's got rubber parts inside. It has a rubber sack. It has an inner cap that's made of hard rubber or vulcanite, and the theory, prevailing theory, is that the outgassing from the deterioration of the hard rubber parts or the rubber sack in the barrel causes this discoloration. And there's nothing you can do about it. There's no amount of polishing or cleaning that will get it off. It's not ink that does it. It's this outgassing of the whatever the heck it is.
Yeah. And what year did they switch from that vulcanite to the other one?
To the celluloid. This started in 1924. Schaefer was a big pen manufacturer. It was the first one to take a risk and change from hard rubber to plastic or celluloid, and that's when they came out with their. Let me.
So 24 is when the materials really changed. And I guess it was just cheaper.
So for example. And more colorful. This is their deluxe pen in 1923. And this is the pen they came out with in 1924. And for 2 years, this was the only color plastic, besides black. There was black. This is hard rubber, and this is an early celluloid. And then you notice that all these pens are, they have flat tops. They're called flat top. They're just cylinders, right? And then in one of the design trends in the late 20s and early 30s was streamlining. And so what the company started doing is they changed their pens to make them streamlined, just like the streamlined railroad engines were starting to become. So first you had this, and then a year later you have this. Mm-hmm. Right? See how they rounded off the ends? And then different things.
Which one?
They'd have a jewel sometimes at the end, right? A little cabochon.
There were some models that had what's called a jewel at the end. Here's an example. This is later in the late 30s, early 40s. This is a Parker Vacuumatic. This is the Maxima, the largest size they made. And we call this little thing at the bottom a jewel. It's really just plastic, the same material that the pen is made from. Ooh. And the metal thing is called a tassy, or that's what pen people call it. They call this bottom thing a jewel. They call this thing a tassy. Cobuchon. Yeah, I mean, there were a lot of decorative things in the eyedropper era, and you occasionally see pens with that'll have like an orb from a precious stone that's sitting on the top. Yeah. It's not something that is there's no particular model that does that, but sometimes you'll see decorative things. Sometimes it's added by jewelers, you know, not actually by the manufacturer.
I got two questions so far since you were talking. What's more collectible, the old flat tops or when they went streamlined? And then
Say that again.
The flat tops, the early
pre-1920s,
what is considered more collectible, the flat tops or when they went streamlined in Art Deco?
There's really no rule there. Yeah, there really isn't any rule. The streamlines are valuable and the flat tops are valuable. I mean, one thing that you need to know is that size matters. For example, you have to know which one you've got. Like, this is a flat top. This is a Parker Duofold Senior from 19. This is it's plastic, so it's 1926. And this is the Duofold Junior from around 1926. And you can see that, like, if you saw these two things, or if you sold one of these on eBay and you put a picture of it with no reference as to the size, the buyers wouldn't know if they had this, you know, $40 pen or this $200 pen. Right?
Interesting.
So that's why when you're selling these things, it's important to give dimensions. Right.
Would the smaller ones be for women with smaller hands?
The smaller ones are generally for women, yeah, or for men to wear in their vest pockets.
Ah, there you go. Okay, so We had a couple of viewer questions. I see Alberto wanted to know, do they have to clean the inside of the pen? Have you ever had to clean the inside of the pens? Like, I guess
that's what I do
when the sack bursts.
Yeah, that's what I do. I buy them, you know, the way I find them in the wild, and I repair them and clean them, and then I, you know, sell them repaired. So yeah, that is one thing that we do. But you know, there's a little bit of art to it, and it's easy to break a pen by fixing it, by repairing it. So the guys I know that I've known for years who buy and sell pens, who are out in the wild all the time, they don't make any attempt to repair pens. The guys that do pens and lighters and vintage this and typewriters and fans and everything, they don't bother to fix pens. You have to, you know, it takes a little bit of expertise and involves a little bit of risk.
Fix them. Right. So the other question we had, Laura had asked, was about how many pen collectors do you think are out there? I know, like, you sell a lot of pens internationally. I know you used to run the New England Pen Show up in Boston. So what would be your estimate of how many collectors are out there of pens?
That's a good question. I mean, there's probably a few dozen to 100 people who make their living full-time buying and selling vintage fountain pens. And there's another few thousand people, you know, who have to do with buying and selling collectible modern pens too, you know, because they're being made now. They're not as good, and they're a lot different, and the whole world of collecting them is different. But how many pen collectors are there? I mean, I don't know. I don't know how to answer that question. I mean,
show, I mean, what was your attendance like just at that one show?
Well, we usually had, maybe 500 people in Boston, and they probably get... The DC show is the biggest, and I'm sure it gets a few thousand.
There's still a lot
of Chicago shows, second biggest.
So there's quite a few collectors out there, huh? But so what about during the Depression era? I know Chad had to step out, but he wants to know how many pens do you think got scrapped for the gold during the Depression? And then in modern times when gold hit an all-time high, did you see a lot of pens getting scrapped for the gold?
Yes, we saw a lot of pens being scrapped for the gold, and there are only certain models that scrapping is worth it. If you're just in the 70s, when pens hadn't really been vintage fountain pens hadn't really been discovered, and the price of gold, you know, private ownership of gold was made legal again, I think by Nixon, right? But between Roosevelt and Nixon, it was illegal to privately own gold. So you couldn't just go to a scrapper and get paid, I don't think. But in the 70s, when the price of gold was high and people could own gold, I think we lost a lot of fountain pens then. And then in the recent during the recent high prices of gold, I know a lot of stuff got scrapped. But it's almost never worth scrapping the gold just for its nib, because there's just not enough gold there. For a number two nib, there's maybe, you know, $6 to $10 worth of gold. And if the pen is complete, you could always get more for that, more for it than that. I mean, in many cases, lots more. I mean, it'd be a shame to, I mean, there are number two size nib pens that might be worth $400, $500, $600, and it's, you know, a shame to scrap it for, you know, to
right.
scrap it for
so what about, $10 worth of gold. Wood-turned pens, do you have any experience with those? Are they collectible, or is that sort of just a hobby thing?
It is. How do I say this? I have a lot of respect for guys who do that, because it's a craft, and they make beautiful stuff, and I see them occasionally, but there's no market for them that I know of.
So it's just one of those things where people buy it because they like it.
People buy it because they like it, yeah.
Right.
Exactly.
Laura Lee wanted to know about pen collectors' conventions, and I know we talked earlier. You said there's like at least one major show a month somewhere in the country.
There's almost one show a month. Yeah, there's, like, right now, this weekend is the Philadelphia Pen Show. Next month is the L.A. Pen Show. I don't know if there's a big one in March, but if you Google Pen Shows, you'll find calendars that will tell you where they are. There's one in sometimes there's one in San Francisco, but not every year. There's been an LA show for many years. There's one in Chicago. There's one of the biggest ones, I think, because of central location, is in Columbus, Ohio, and it's in the fall. Possibly the biggest one is Washington, D.C., which is in August. Okay. There's one in Houston, Little Rock, Miami in the summer when the rates are good. There's a pen show. There are 8 to 12 respectable size pen shows, and there are lots of pen clubs, regional pen clubs that have occasional meetings, so that if you know there are a few people in your city that are pen collectors, you can get together with them and share your finds.
Well, that's been great, right? I mean, I hate to cut you off, but I guess we could always get you back on another time. I guess we'll do a question from Chad, and then Elena's got another one. So Chad wants to know, how do you empty your bladder when it's time to release the ink? And I also want to add that, Rob, you have provided the record number of sexual innuendos for our viewers this week. If you haven't watched the YouTube chat, we have a lot of perverts that watch us, and they have appreciated your descriptions.
Oh, my. Okay.
Especially
I know you would appreciate that, Rob. That's why I mentioned it.
Yeah, thanks a lot. Especially after...
what do you do about getting ink out of the bladders? I mean, do you just pull it apart? Doesn't it go everywhere? Or?
Well, first of all, you have to check to make sure your health insurance coverage is fully paid up. Then you make an appointment with your local...
Is it like a pen doctor?
With your local physician. Oh, yeah.
Wait a minute.
And then
I have to go to the bathroom, guys. I gotta go.
So you are a pen doctor? We can. That's like your profession.
I'm not really a pen doctor. There are people that repair fountain pens for a living. I am too nervous to repair other people's fountain pens because there's always, when you open up a pen to get the innards out, there's always a 2% chance that you're gonna break it. So I don't mind doing that for my own pens, but I would hate to do it to somebody else.
Where do you get most of your pens from? I mean, do you specifically only go to shows because you're looking for, you know, like unique high value ones, or do you ever shop eBay and get, you know, find some maybe hidden gems there, or where do you get most of your stuff?
Well, you know, over the years, the Picker's Market has. I used to go to antique shows and flea markets. And now a lot of that stuff has moved to eBay, so I spend a lot of time scrolling through listings and seeing if I see anything good. So yeah, I get a lot of stuff from pen shows. I get some stuff from auctions, which are great. Live auctions are great, but I'm always looking through eBay too, just like everybody else. And I've got maybe a couple things a week always in the mail from eBay.
Wow.
Right. Oh, very cool. Did you ask her a question, Elena? I can't remember.
No. He had mentioned earlier talking about the eyedrop era. I've actually never heard of that terminology. So I was just wondering, like, what era is that? Like, what time frame, and how did it get named the eyedrop era?
Well, I just mean the time when fountain pens were filled with an eyedropper rather than having their own ink supply. These guys like this. So you see that, you notice there's no lever, and the reason there's no lever down here is because you unscrew this thing and you drop the ink directly into the barrel with an eyedropper.
Okay.
And this is what we had. It's still called a fountain pen because it still carries its own ink supply, but you had to fill it with an eyedropper every time you filled it up. And that was maybe between 1884, which is the first practical Waterman fountain pen patent, and it's largely credit. He's Lewis Edson Waterman, the founder of the Waterman Company, is generally credited with designing the first practical fountain pen, and that was in 1884.
What was the bladder made out of?
It's rubber. Now that's later when you start with bladder. These are some sacks.
I use
to repair pens with.
So when did the droplet go, you know, end, rough age, like the years that it started going all over to the bladder versus the eyedroppers?
Okay, say that again.
Like, when did the dropping the ink into the fountain pens, like, end? Like, what date?
Okay, that was around, it was the early 20s. And some eyedrop-filling fountain pens remained popular even after most pens became lever-filling pens with a rubber sack. For example, there's something called a safety pen, which is this, which remained popular in Europe even after we had moved to lever-filling pens in the United States. And with a safety pen, you still fill it with an eyedropper. You drop the ink right in here. But instead of the nib being there for you to unscrew, the nib comes up when you twist the back of the pen. This is called a safety pen, and it's an eyedrop. It's a style of eyedrop filling pen. It was first designed probably around 1900, maybe a little bit before, and it remained. You see Italian safety pens made into the 30s and 40s.
That is awesome. Thank you.
Very cool. And I hate to cut you off, Rob. If you want, join over in the YouTube chat, because I'm sure there's some honest questions and some that you'll find humorous as well. But you're welcome to stay on the show and make comments and ask questions about the items that the panel members are going to show. We're not running you off, but
I'd like to do that.
I'm sure there'll be more questions over in the YouTube chat as well, though, that they'll want to address with you. Hopefully they'll keep it somewhat on topic. Rob, again, you know, thank you for coming on talking about pens, and honestly, we'll probably have you back because it seems like there's a lot more content that you could bless us with. And I know even my brother is enjoying watching the show right now as he's sending me text messages.
Oh, great. Hi, Brian.
Yeah, there you go. Give him a shout out. So again, Rob, you know, we really appreciate you having on. And
no problem.
We're going to move forward, and let's see. We'll go ahead and we'll kick it off with Drew, and let Drew show us what he's got this evening.
Okay, guys. Hey, thanks, everybody. And I enjoyed that segment on fountain pens. That was great. Starting off with this little ornament from a piece of 18th century furniture in the Gothic era. It's just a little piece, a little fragment that came off of a long console of some sort, ornate console. And he's like a sad lion. They call this the sad lion. Kind of got a little frown, but he's pretty cool. A couple hundred years old on this guy.
So what, like 1850s around there?
No, I'd say this is 18th century, so 1700s on this.
Oh, wow. Okay, yeah. I was thinking Victorian Gothic.
Yeah.
And how were you able to date it properly? Of the sad dog face, it was popular?
Yeah, then? Just the comparison and such. I mean, it might be right at the cutoff line, 1790s, 1810, you know. Just a very cool little carving I found at some yard sale, I think. And next, a really nice little piece of Russian enamel. And this is a salt cellar, what's called a salt cellar. And people put their salt in here, and they usually use a small spoon like this. This one's a little large for this one, but probably a little smaller than that. But the enameling on this is really beautiful. Berries and leaves. I don't know if you guys are picking up on that. It's got an insert with glass that's still original. Usually you'll see that all broken. And the manufacturer is called Homet, or sometimes people confuse this with Iomet because the H doesn't have a connecting bar in between, so it looks like Iomet, but it's actually Homet. And it's probably silver plated, but just beautiful little salt cellar, they call that.
That's pretty cool.
Let's see. Also from the kitchen world, some of you young whippersnappers probably never saw one of these. This is, you guys go to Starbucks and get your coffee all pre-ground and whatever. This is how they used to grind them in the old days, guys. Beautiful, old, primitive coffee grinder mill, they would call that.
What's the joinery on that? Is that dovetailed, or is it
not,
just
it's not
it up?
Dovetailed. It's not dovetailed on this one, unfortunately, but sometimes you'll see the overlapping joints or the dovetails, but this is painted, so there was no real need to do that. It's nailed at the corners. It's probably, I think it's mitered at the corners, so the craftsmanship is pretty darn good.
Yeah, it looks like it's got a nice whitewash on it.
Yeah. It's you're probably not picking up on the color, but it's more like seafoam green.
Okay. So do you think it could be like a milk paint or something, or do you think that was a regular, like a commercial produced paint?
Well, it's so long ago, it's hard to tell. This is 120 years old or something.
And you would see the same type of like pastel type colored paints like on the dough bowls and different items from that era, right?
I would imitate these kind of colors.
Yeah.
Being that it is so
primitive with the joinery and stuff, it's probably some sort of like a homemade milk paint or something that's on it.
Look at the handle. This is a cast iron with a wooden handle, this little spindle. It's got a little break right there, but a little loss, but still works. It still spins around.
Yeah.
Sometimes these have a little lid to them that opens and closes, but this one never had the lid because I don't see any holes for the hinge.
Right. That's a pretty cool piece. Do you think Chad could grind his Starbucks in there?
I think so.
I love it.
That's neat. I can appreciate that piece. You can see the age on that one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I got a question about the salt cellar. Did they have those before salt shakers? Was that like pre salt shakers, or
this would be like for fine dining? You know, back in the day, they'd have large table settings, and you'd have maybe a little salt cellar for a little section of the table. And as far as pepper mills, I'm not sure about that. But you'd also have these little great little containers for your butter. Each person would have like a little nice little dispenser, little pad, for your butter. And you had your own bread plate, and you had like 12 different, serving utensils. So I think these were basically four table settings in a formal setting.
Okay, I was just wondering if it was easy to date. I've come across those, and I never knew what they were.
And they're great for sugar. I mean, they work really great for sugar or salt. That one's going to be hard to sell because it's so nice. It's Russian, and Russian enamel is like some of the best stuff you'll ever run into.
Oh, yeah. their enamel is absolutely gorgeous. I actually I buy the Russian enamel eggs for my wife periodically when I find them because she has some Russian heritage.
I mean,
they really are just beautiful pieces. That, when it comes to militaria, the Russians have some of the nicest enamel medals and badges as far as militaria collecting goes. So their enamel across the board is appreciated by a lot of different collectors.
And of course, we all know about Fabergé.
We have a few of those.
The greatest enamel egg maker of all time for the Tsar and his family.
Yeah.
I saw a whole show on that the other day. I thought it was fascinating to learn that.
Yeah, we have actually, I don't remember what the date is on it, but we actually have one of the signed crystal Fabergés.
Oh, that's great.
I actually picked it up on a misplaced listing on eBay about 4 years ago.
Cool. Wow. This is a little wood carving, probably Mexican. Could be Spanish also or Portuguese, but I have a feeling it's probably Mexico. But it's a nice three-dimensional Mary. And there's some little guy down here, and I think he's holding up a... I think this is a turtle. I don't know. Somebody correct me, because he's holding up something, and I don't know who this is, but anybody know about that?
Raise it up a little bit. Yeah, I mean, it kind of looks like a turtle, but that looks a little...
Head. I think this is the head.
A little refined for Mexican carving, though.
You think so?
Yeah, I mean, it could be... It could be, like, South American.
Yeah.
Yeah, Mexican carvings tend to be a bit cruder.
Yeah.
They're nice, but they tend to not be so polished and refined, you know?
And I think this is mahogany, so this is some nice wood. It's some hardwood. And I know you're going to show some cool religious significant stuff later on. Did I ever show you guys... Tell me if I showed you these already, but I did a video, but did I show you these on your channel?
No, I don't think we've seen those yet.
All right. These are cool. They're large cement-like figures of Mary, and I have one of Jesus. And what they're called is, they're called fiber stone. And it's a fibrous type of material that's mixed with stone that makes it a little bit lighter than straight concrete. But the detail on this is really amazing. And there's your rosary and your cross right there.
Yeah.
And so those are really cool. I think this came off a church or something, because it looks like it was built into something like a niche of some sort.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah, I have one of Jesus.
Well, you got some great stuff to show this week, Drew. We're gonna slide over to Brian real quick, because he picked up a little find today. Well, you got one more to show us? All right, show us Jesus.
And here's the man himself. Jesus. Yeah.
That's pretty cool. And what time frame did you put on those?
This is probably like they aren't real super old, but they're probably 19. I'm saying like 30s, 40s.
Okay.
Somewhere in there. Could be a little bit older. But they're heavy. I mean, each one weighs like 12 pounds or something like that. So they're pretty darn heavy. Do I got more time?
No, we're going to switch over to Brian, because we're going to squeeze him in this week.
You guys are going to have to wait till next week then. Okay.
Yeah. Oh, we'll keep them begging.
All right. If you need me to fill in later on, but let me know.
Oh, we know. All right, Brian, what you got for us this week?
All right, went out to do a little sourcing today and ran across something in your little area of Militaria. Found this 1982 yearbook of the 82nd Airborne. Comes with a nice gold metal jump wings up here. And this basically was a special thing from what I found out in my research tonight. They claimed 1982 was the year of the 82nd Airborne. So, as you have explained to me, that these books are usually pretty special. They usually don't do them for a division book like this.
Yeah, it's pretty uncommon to find division level yearbooks. Normally they're done at the unit level. To do an entire division would have been pretty extensive.
And they do break it down to all the little units. You see there's no names, but each little company and things like that. And it goes into the history of the 82nd Airborne, too, about where they came from. It's got interesting drawings. If I can get this right in here. about Divardi. They got hand drawings that are in there that were printed out.
Right.
It's just, I've looked through it some, and it's a pretty neat book. I was never in that unit, but it's still neat to learn the history of some of the larger units.
Any of the military unit histories are going to be desirable by somebody. But generally, like I refer to some of the divisions, such as like the 82nd and the 101st, as Hollywood divisions as far as collectors go, because they've made movies about these guys, and it drives a Hollywood collecting market. You know, every time there's a movie released, the collecting market booms. It's just like Fury released, and the second armored stuff is just flying out of eBay. Because you get a lot of Hollywood collectors that, you know, they just want to collect it because they've seen it in the movie. You know, they appreciate it, but it's just different. And the 82nd is one of those Hollywood divisions that they've made a lot of movies about.
Same thing happens with the comic books.
And right. it even goes beyond just, like, the seriousness of it. They'll go into, I'm having a hard time seeing my camera this way.
But oh, yeah, it looks like football games and...
And just what they do in general, just it's not all serious training, but all training has some purpose.
Right.
Team loving with football, or I think whenever I was in, we were doing the frisbee football or something like that. Just different things, and it seems to really cover into all the general aspects of being in that unit. So, but it was a pretty neat find.
It really was. I was happy to get some pictures of it. That's. You know, like I said, military unit history books, they're always worth picking up if you find them. You know, because it serves more than one purpose to a collector. I've got a whole shelf full of them because it gives me insight and history into the units, but also into the uniforms, equipment, and all kinds of other things that they were doing, because those are pictures in time, you know, of these guys and what they're wearing and what they're doing. So definitely a lot of history held in those yearbooks. So we're going to slide over here to Elena. Hello, Elena.
Hello. Yay. I didn't get too much. I just wanted to touch on two real easy to observe designs in the mid-century of different plastics or different rhinestones that are easy to pick up, and that one of, not a favorite, but one that I can appreciate. Now, to go into it a little bit, if you watched my previous videos, or the first Catacomb, or, oh gosh, there I go, not being able to pronounce things again, but you'll know I touched basis on Bakelite and different plastics, and around the 1940s, around the time Catalin took over Bakelite, they're making Bakelite. Bakelite was just in around the ending. They came out with Lucite. And Lucite has no seams whatsoever, and it's just a plastic. And there's something called Moon Glow, which is a very specific look to plastic, to the Lucite during that time period. And what it is, it looks like a cat's eye. If you've seen Cat's Eye, the difference would be it's plastic. It's not stone. It's not hard. And this will go, this is between the range of like Lucite and Bakelite as price points wise. But there are specific people that only collect Moon Glow type of pieces in Lucite. It will come in blue, pink, green. The main thing is that you see how it has that cat eye look to it. Can you guys see that okay?
Yeah.
So that's just a good terminology to know, and that's like I said, mid-century. So it's, wow, it's like 60 years old. Then you have Aurora Borealis.
Borealis.
Thank you. What would I do without you? Like, seriously. I can tell you how to spell it really good.
You mean really well?
really well. Oh my goodness. Is this a grammar lesson or is this
Where's Danica at? Where's Danica?
That's what I need. I can tell you all about the items though. This is a good example. You see that? It's the rainbow iridescence.
Mm-hmm.
Now these are glass, they're hard, and it has that iridescent look. And this specific type of rhinestone, also called AB rhinestone for short, let me get out my notes, was developed by Swarovski. No, I can't say it now. And I was saying it.
Swarovski.
Thank you. I was
saying it.
Yeah, it's the swan symbol. Well, he made that and perfected it in 1955. Christian Dior worked very close with Manfred Swarovski, grandson of the founder, and was first to use the AB rhinestones. The first few years of production, only top designers were licensed for use, and they were popular until the 1960s. So usually when you see these, if they're not signed, you're looking at like 1960s, because the top designers usually had their pieces signed unless it was on a piece of paper or a tag that is no longer. This one, however, this one's 1950s because of the class, so I know a top designer did make this. Unfortunately, I don't know who it is. But those were the two things that I wanted to touch on tonight.
Awesome.
Yeah, these are very collectible. You're usually looking 20 and up for something that's a bracelet or a necklace. Especially the sign pieces, forget it.
Very cool. So does that wrap you up for tonight? No 30-minute spiel?
Would you like me to test you? Okay. How does this date? What time period?
Oh, we're supposed to remember what you just told us? I'm going to go with it is post-1900.
I have an excuse. I'm going to watch the chat out here.
I want to say you said it was like 30s or 40s.
Yeah, I was going to say cat's eye is probably 30s, 40s. Could be 50s.
Moon glow, lucite. Lucite didn't come out till 1940s. It was like 1940s, 1960s. Moon glow. No, but I was joking about
that. Note of that.
Part. You were close.
Yes.
Awesome. Polly Anna Wilson was listening because she guessed 60s, so somebody was listening to you, Elena.
I was listening, but I got it last week, so I didn't want to, make these guys look bad.
Oh, thank you.
We appreciate it, Dan, and for that, I'm going to let you speak tonight.
Oh, yay. Thank you.
So we'll move on over to Dan. What you got for us, Dan? We're hoping Chad's going to get back in here because he had some interesting spirits to talk about tonight. So hopefully he'll get back with us and fill us in.
Let me do some camera adjusting because this guy's bad boy's a little big. So I don't know if you can see it very well. This is an Ingram 8-day time and strike clock. I picked it up last weekend, actually. It's on one of my videos as I found it. But I've been doing a lot more research on it, right, since I got it. And this is like probably one. Well, I do buy a lot of clocks. One of my other passions is clock collecting. And I do have to say that this last 2 weeks ago, actually for a Christmas present, I was given a six-week course in clock repair, antique clock repair. So every Wednesday night I go and I've now stripped the clock completely to pieces. I mean the movement completely to pieces, cleaning it, and then next week I'm going to see if I can put it all back together again from my pictures and my drawings and diagrams. But anyhow, so I have a pile of old clocks that are just that I bought it. You know, for dirt cheap, nothing. That they're just really cool looking, and they're really old. And so I'm going to start working on them, getting them together. But one of the things I'd like to do is, while I'm learning this stuff, is maybe help give everybody some tips on, you know, buying a clock. If you just want to be a collector, you just like clocks. You know, how you find one, and how do you know it's going to work, and what to look for in it, and stuff like that. So I may be doing some videos on that here soon. But anyhow, this is a 19. They made these around 1915, circa 1915, Ingram, and it's an 8-day, what they mean by 8-day time and strike. So 8-day means when you wind this thing up, it's going to run for 8 days. The springs in it are capable of holding energy for about 8 days. The time and strike part means that it keeps time. And that it's got a chime. It strikes on the hour. This particular one strikes on the hour, but it also strikes on the half hour, but not on a gong. It strikes on a bell. So every half hour there's a bell that rings, and then on the hour there's a gong that rings. I'm gonna run it through its paces here in a minute and see if you can hear it, because it's really pretty. And that's what makes me want to keep a clock or not, is what it sounds like. And I love, first thing I do is I test the chime on a clock, and some of the sounds that these things make are just amazing. Especially something built like this. This is a super quality American made, you know, clock that would have been, that were making them since the early 1860s or 1850s, different designs. This particular model, when they made these models, they would not use serial numbers. They would use names, and I don't know if you can see the name on this. Is called the Adrian, and it's actually, it's been running, and it's actually starting to chime right now as I'm tipping it here. So it was called the Adrian model. Let me show you the front real quick. There's some features on this one that makes it kind of cool. Let me do a little bit of adjusting, camera adjusting. So this is all brass. This outer layer here on the glass is brass. This is a glass face on here. Open it up. This is all brass in here, and then the centerpiece in here is brass. This has, these are two arbors for winding. So one winds up the time part of it, and then the other winds up the strike part, which is the gong part of it. One of the things for, if you know, one way to test a clock right off is you wind it. If there's a key available, and honestly, when I go out picking, I have three clock keys that I carry on my keychain so that I can accommodate different types of clocks. If I want to test it and they say, oh, we don't have the key or whatever, oh, no problem, I got one right here. So I wind it up, and you could tell if the spring's broken or not, because once you get toward the end, or you wind it about four times, it'll unwind itself. You'll hear it go bling, you'll hear it click, or you hear it bang or something like that. That means basically that it's broken. Now there is a popping sound that it will make during winding, but it doesn't necessarily that it's broken. It means that the spring might be rusty. You might need to put it, might not, or it's got so much grease on it that it's dirty, it's sticky, and it's glued together. So as the spring either unwinds, it'll pop, or as you're winding it, it'll stick and it'll pop. You know, it makes it stick and then it pop as it's going around. But you'll know if it's broken, because you'll never be able to wind it tight. You just keep winding, 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 and you get to a point and it unloads inside of there because the end's broken, and it'll go off. That's not the end of the world. It's you know, I'm learning how to do this kind of stuff, but for most people, it's the most dangerous piece to work on in a clock. You can like lose a finger working on springs on a clock. It's really bad. I got a bruise on my wrist where I got hit by a clock spring that unwound unexpectedly, whacked me on the arm, and I had a bruise for quite a few days on it. But they could be pretty dangerous.
I got a question for you. You said you carry three keys. How many variations of keys are out there? Is it pretty much just the general three? And
well,
are they pretty cheap to pick up, do you know?
It depends. You can buy reproduction keys pretty cheap. If you're buying like the original, you know, Sessions, you know, antique key, you're going to be paying about, you know, $15 for it, maybe $20 for one of those. You can buy reproduction ones for a lot less, maybe $6 or $8. You know, keep your eyes out on estate sales, slot meets, because there's always, you're always going to find some keys somewhere. Now, why I carry three different numbers. The square hole in the middle of the key, and I don't have the key to this one, unfortunately, because I didn't bring it with me. The key hole is square, and there's different sizes. The most common size...
Are you holding it? Because I can't see it.
No, I'm not holding it. I'm just...
Oh, okay.
I do that when I talk. The most common key size is the number eight size, and those are that's usually inscribed on the key. There's also a 6 and a 4. And I carry those. Those seem to be the most common also. Usually it's the 8. The 8 and 6 are the ones that you use the most. So that's, you know, carry those around. Those
and share, and Dan, share with us why there's two key slots right there.
Okay, I thought I did. All right, so.
You said one's for the time and one's for the dong.
Oh, sorry, I didn't hear that.
time and strikes. One is the time side, and one side of the clock manages running the time. The other side manages running the gong, and that's what they call the time and strike. So, yeah, sometimes there are three, and the third one or second one is often used for additional time. 30-day clocks tend to have those on there, too. So, anyhow. This particular thing, too, this also has, it's going to be hard to see. Well, let me see if I can get a gong out of this while I'm sitting here. Let me open this up so you can hear it. I'll stick the microphone in there. It's already hit. I'm going the wrong way. Sorry.
Did you just really move that hand backwards?
You can go back for about a 20-minute stretch. You can only go back about 15 minutes, yeah. You don't want to do... See, did you hear the bell go off? That was the... I'm looking at my camera, and it's everything's backwards in my camera, and that's why I went backwards.
You're going to lose a finger, Dan.
Looks like that one needs a little more work.
Yeah. Well, as always, Dan...
What's going... You just can't hear it, I guess. It's pretty faint.
Ingram.
I heard a little bit.
You'll have to do a video, Dan, and post it up on the catacombs.
I got a video of this clock, and I think you can hear it chiming also. It's already up there. I posted last week, but if you look at my YouTube channel, it's like this next to the like last video that I did.
Awesome.
Just a quick look too inside. There's the bell that it strikes when it's on the half hour.
Yeah.
You can see it's all brass.
Ingram's a great third tier type of clock behind Simon Wilmot and Seth Thomas and Ingram's like right there. I have a really nice Ingram clock. They're made in Connecticut.
Yeah. These pieces too are, you want to look for these kind of things, what pieces are missing on your clock too if you're going looking for one. These are all brass here. This is marble. This is actually it's kind of a marble overlay on the wood. It's not really marble, but it's got this look here.
Veneer.
Yeah, it's like a veneer that they lay over. They make two different kinds. This model, they made a red and white marble looking paint, and then this is a green and white one. Most of the ones, they polish all these up. This has not been touched. I have not done anything to the case except just dust it off, and that's it. I'm going to polish all of the brass up on this thing, give it a lot more pizzazz. There's one more feature on this, and it's actually etched. You might see some of the etching very lightly right in here. There's etching along the base part. You can see the diamond shape kind of in the middle right in there. There's a line going right along here. That's etching. And a lot of them, they will fill that with a gold paint so the etching stands out really easily right in there. So
very, very, very cool. Well, as always, Dan, your stuff is amazing and your knowledge is great, and we appreciate it. And we'll probably have you on more often. Maybe we'll have to extend the show out a little bit.
Thanks.
So, but we do appreciate it. We're going to move over to Chad and his spirits of the night.
You know, it's going to be a real quick thing. A lot of people just don't know, but the old whiskey bottles, this is a Gilby Spray Royal Dancing Scott decanter. And if you look, they actually came out with it. It was full of whiskey. And they're collectibles. They come out with them, and it's a music box, and it's got a...
I see why it's collectible.
It's just got a little dancing Scott in there. Can you hear it?
Yeah.
Yeah, and they come out with it. This is probably 50s to late 60s. I've seen some that they've talked about them early 70s, but it's got the stamp on it, and I can't get it legible, the alcohol tax stamp on it. But this was Kim's great-grandfather's, so this was passed down to her, and she likes her trinkets and her music boxes and stuff like that. But, yeah, whiskey decanters, you know, they come out with different, like, cars and just all kinds of different, like, shapes of them. But it's taking it a step further, you know, and putting, like, music boxes and stuff like that in them. Can you imagine the amount of money that they have to pay just to put in the bottle of the whiskey? So these special edition things, they are collected by a lot of people. So if you ever come across something like this, you know, look into it, because you might have some good money. Not that we talk about money here, but it's just a really neat thing, and it's literally a music box attached to the bottle. So they're really neat, and this was actually bottled by Bean Company, but it's made in Scottish whiskey, 86 proof.
That is awesome. I was gonna say, was it Scottish, because it looked like a kilt. Or
yeah, it's a dancing. It's called the Dancing Scott.
Nice.
So, yeah.
And then I have a question for you, because I've sold like old empty decanters that had the tax strip on it.
Uh huh.
But looking at it, I never thought to ask, like, what was the time period? Like, why did they do that? Do you know the history behind the tax stamps and everything?
No, I don't.
Okay. You know, I love that stuff, so I just know
the same with tobacco. It's the way they were able to tax it, and it's the same idea. I don't know when it all started, but I do know that... you can identify a lot of stuff by the tax, because there's a lot of times there's dates, right. There's dates on your tax stamps and everything else. So
it was done basically to prove that you paid your taxes on it. Just like when I talk about the tintypes and stuff and the CDBs during the Civil War that have the photograph tax stamps on it. You know that you have to have it has to be canceled out. The only way you can get those is by paying for them. So it just proves that the tax has been paid on that particular bottle.
Okay.
So, because you get a lot of that with miniatures. You'll see the old miniatures. I'll have to show some of those one night. I have hundreds of them. But they have the tax stamps on them, and it just shows that the taxes were paid on the liquor. Got to pay Uncle Sam, you know.
Oh, yeah.
Now, you said you had hundreds of them. Got one question for you. Were you the one who paid all your tax?
Hell no. No, I'll tell you why I have so many. Because, you know, I wheel and deal in anything I can. And I bought a collection of about 1,500 of them. And I got about halfway through the collection, and eBay changed their rules. And you could no longer sell liquor on eBay. Even if it's collectible liquor. So guess what happened to my sales of collectible miniature liquor bottles?
Tell me about it.
They're not empty.
No. This was a collection.
Oh.
Yeah.
I wonder if you dump them out, but
you kill the value.
I know that.
I actually sold.
There's ways to get around it, and I did take some hits periodically, but they just don't sell like they used to because you can't openly advertise them for what they are.
Right.
Yeah, I sold sealed tobacco with the tax stamp, you know, on the metal tins. I sold those on eBay.
Yeah. So what I do with them is I put them in my booth. Yeah. I put a couple dozen. I sell them periodically. People still come in and buy them, especially the ones that are, you know, I've got them from all over the world. So the ones from Europe tend to be real frugal, you know, fancy, and people buy them just because they think they look cool, you know. So fortunately, I made my money back, so I wasn't out money, you know. But, yeah, I have a couple boxes of them. So, well, great, Chad. We learned something new about music boxes and liquor and how they mix.
Yeah. When you get hammered, you can sit there and watch the little Scott guy dance.
Right?
Well, I see that happening.
And I'm going to show this a little bit, and then I'm going to let Brian do some shout-outs. That way it has a chance to catch up, and people might be able to guess what it is. And not the obvious guess. We all know that it's a crucifix. So let me see if it'll focus in there.
Put your hand right behind.
The base of the crucifix that matters.
Erik, place your hand right behind it flat.
Oh, yeah. I'll take a lesson from Rob.
Hey, focus, yeah.
Did it focus in?
Yep.
But you got to lock you on because we're...
Yeah, lock your
video on you.
It should be locked on me. Yeah, you guys might just not be seeing it locked on, that's all.
We see everybody.
Dead men tell no tales.
You're right. So, Brian, go ahead and do some shout-outs. I know we've had a bunch of people in the chat tonight, and I'll give it a little chance to catch up, and then I'll discuss it.
All right, well, let's get to it. First name I see is got Biohazard Picker. How's it going, Adam? Caesar's Palace is in there. There's Wade Harrod, Polly Ann Wilson, Alabama Dust Bunny Pickers, Sabina. A bunch of these people have been around most of the night. Philip Silverman. There's Alberto. If YouTube would stop freezing on me. Of course, Sean Cool Toads. He's been around for a long time tonight.
What's up, Sean?
Alvin Smith, Jay Zepp. Of course, this is doing this again.
Laura Lee.
Laura Lee.
What's up, Laura Lee?
Swamp Picker.
I know Wade is out there. I've seen him.
I think I already called his name out. Wade Aaron, if I'm pronouncing that correctly. Brooks Lawn Bargains. Joseph Hare, just seeing you again.
Oh, it looks like Dusty might be the only one out there that actually is somewhat correct.
Dang.
All right, so we'll talk about it now. Now that I've had my Elena fun for the evening, making people guess stuff. So it is a religious piece. It's actually Catholic. And it is a real cross. They had a skull and crossbones on the crosses from about the late 1700s up until about the 1940s. And there's multiple stories out there. The basic one is that it does symbolize Goliath, as Dusty pointed out. And it is Jesus rising above the skull of Goliath and the bones of Adam, because he was crucified at the place where Adam, I believe it was where Adam died or where Adam was born. So that's the symbolism behind the skull and crossbones.
The Golgotha was a hill that Christ was supposedly crucified, and it looked like a skull, actually. It appeared to be like a skull.
Right, yeah. There we go. This is why I have a panel.
And I believe...
yeah, so that's the symbolism. It's Jesus rising above that.
Ah.
That's the symbolism, and it was used by the Catholic Church. So this one in particular, and I have two of them sitting here. This one, I'm not sure if the chain is original. I'm going to let Elena date the clasp, and that will tell me whether the chain is possibly original.
Hey, Erik, on the hands, or where the nails are nailed into the hands, is it nailed into the hands or the wrists?
The hands.
Okay.
It's the hands on both of them. And it's actually, on these, they are actually nailed all the way through.
Mm-hmm.
They're actual
nails.
Yeah, they're actually nailed. Like, the workmanship of these are just beautiful.
Yeah.
But, so there's the clasp, Elena. what's the? Well, I know it's broke.
The larger one, the older. Is it fairly large in comparison?
I would say just under a dime.
Yeah, so that's fairly large. So.
That nub on it that you always talk about.
That's a regular spring clasp. And the larger one could be an indication that it's older, but they're still made today. So okay. You have to look at the other parts. But it could go into the 19th century and 20th
okay.
century.
Well, then it most likely, it's probably the original chain that was used to wear this particular one, because this one does, it appears to be nickel-plated brass, and this one is probably from anywhere from, like, 1910 into the 1940s, for the way that this one is produced, because it's not hand-cut, it's all machine-made, so that tells me it's definitely not older.
And that's like cut steel, the way the nails go through, where the steel's cut on the other side, which is the terminology in jewelry.
Okay.
And then another thing that I wanted to say, I learned this before I started saving my notes in Evernote. I went to go look it up. But the older class, like the real older ones, didn't have the crucifix, Jesus hanging on them. They were just regular crosses. And then... right, I think it's like late 1800s is when Jesus started going on the crosses. So that whether he's on the cross or not can help date it as well.
Right.
I just don't know.
You know, I have seen some of these. These are called pectoral crosses, and I have seen them dated into the late 1700s with Jesus on them, where they were worn in the Catholic Church like this by bishops and priests. You'll see the larger versions worn by the monks around their waist. So now this one here, this one's going to date into probably the mid-1800s. And it is actually hand-cut. The Jesus would have been poured into a mold, but he's filed down. You can see there's file striations where they cleaned it all up, and the same thing with the cross. You can see the striations where they hit it with a file to clean it up.
Mm-hmm.
And then they hand cut the hanger. You see how it's kind of oblong, not perfectly cut, like it wasn't done on a machine?
Yeah.
So this one's pretty cool. And it's inlaid with, this is probably
30s?
An ebony or something. What's that?
Right, not right. 30s, 40s.
Yeah, I would say probably like 1830s, 1840s.
Yeah.
So that's my tidbit for the evening. I thought everybody would get a kick out of the skull and bones. I was talking earlier with some other people. A lot of times you'll see the ones that are the later 1800s, early 1900s. We'll say like made in Germany. Or some of the other countries where they made them on the back. And people often, they'll see that skull and crossbones and see made in Germany, and they'll automatically assume it has something to do with the Nazis. and it doesn't. But you'll see them listed on eBay and all over the place where they'll call this some sort of Third Reich cross, you know, mm-hmm. something like that. People that just don't know, you know. So, but looks like Sabine wanted to know what difference does the placement of the nails make, Drew?
Oh, it's always depicted that he was crucified through the hands, but they did scientific studies and they said a man of that size it would have probably pulled through the ligaments. So they're more convinced that he was crucified through the wrist bone, which actually has a place for the nail to go through and hold him up there. So it's also so gruesome, but that might be the historical fact that he was actually crucified through the wrist.
Right. Oh, interesting.
Yeah.
So, well, that's going to wrap it up tonight. I believe, I haven't confirmed it yet, but I'm going to have another Rob on next week talking militaria. Hopefully I'll have it confirmed by this weekend. He's a big Korean War collector, so he'll be on talking about his, you know, his collection and stuff. And, you know, so we've got the Collector's Catacomb again next Thursday. Tomorrow we've got the Toadcast with Sean, Mr. Cool Toads. We also have a big announcement for the resellers out there tomorrow on the Toadcast, so make sure you tune in for that. It's always a fun show, you know. And so let's see, do we got Picker's Church Sunday, Chad?
Yes. Picker's Church is back this Sunday, 2:00 Eastern Time. Central Time, I'm sorry. And we're excited about it. It's nice to get back in the flow of things. But yeah, it'll be there.
Awesome. And then Monday, we're going to, Danica and Deb are starting their show up with their panel. I wish I remembered the time. I want to say it's like 8 or 9 o'clock Eastern Time, somewhere in there. So check it out in the Reseller Society or the Reseller Wake Up. I'm sure it will be posted there as well. Speaking of the Wake Up, Monday through Friday, 9:00 Eastern, we with Paul, we have the Reseller Wake Up every day for 2 hours. That's always a great show. And then starting back, I believe, on the 25th is going to be Chris Walking Picker with his show on Sundays.
I think Danica's show, I think it's called the Double D Girls Show. Yeah, Danica and Deb, the Double D Girls Show.
Yeah, that's word on the street, but I'm not sure if that's official or hearsay yet.
Oh, okay. I just want to throw it out there. I know it was talked about.
And then, of course, the meet and greet next Wednesday.
Yes.
So that should wrap it up for all the shows and what's going on, you know, going forward. So again, we appreciate Rob coming on talking about his pens and all that great information, and hopefully we'll have him back again. And we're going to stick around for a little while. I'll post the link if you guys want to jump in and ask some questions or show off some pieces. Feel free to hang out with us for a little while. We'll be around for at least another 30 minutes or so. But again, from the panel of the Collector's Catacomb, thanks for watching, and we'll see you next week.
Thank you.
Hey, good night. Bro.